I'm Christopher Lydon. This is The Connection. Our guest, Stephen Jay Gould, is the most widely recognized authority in our time on the still disputed science of Darwinism and evolution. It's a hot seat to be on. He's a target of the more Darwin than Darwin evolutionary psychologists. And of course, he's also a target of the masses of outright anti-Darwinians. Part of what confounds his rival is that Steve Gould, in his books and his famous magazine essays, writes not just brilliantly, but with his heart on his scientific sleeve. Evolution, he suggests, is not an alien science or an entirely cold, algorithmic grinding out of meaningless change. The glue in our family scrapbooks, the human hunger for continuity, he writes, is somehow akin to the most amazing truth we can see in life on Earth, that it's been going on for 3.5 billion years without a moment's blackout, without a single all-killing frost. It has something to do, he writes, with his own emotion around the story of his immigrant grandparents landing in New York just 100 years ago next year. Why the documentation of heredity through generations of forebears brings us so swiftly to tears and to such a secure sense of rightness, definition, membership, and meaning is hard to know, he says in the new Natural History magazine. But he writes, I simply accept the primal emotional power we feel when we manage to embed ourselves in something so much larger. Connection listeners, where do you stand on Darwin's dangerous idea? And has Stephen Jay Gould helped you out? We're talking with Stephen Jay Gould this hour on the occasion of his 300th and last column for Natural History magazine. 1-800-423-8255 makes the connection. Or you can join Steve Gould online at theconnection.org. Welcome back, Stephen Jay Gould. It's just a year ago we were celebrating Haydn's creation.
That's right, before the last millennial transition. Some people say we're having another one
this month. The Castro.
That's right, because I sang Haydn's creation on New Year's Day 2000, and we were talking about that. A good combination with what we're talking about today.
Steve, make the roots connection. Your last piece is about several things. It's about the Huxley family, but it's about your own family, and it's on the general theme that family emotion is somehow 6 or 66 degrees removed from the whole story.
Well, Chris, I think it is the point you made in your introduction, and in truth, I don't understand it. It's something psychologically deep within us. Why does the subject of evolution fascinate us so deeply? It's not only that it's overwhelmingly factually documented, because many things are that don't touch us to the core in that sense or incite our interest. I think it is the roots phenomenon writ large. For some reason, we understand that we're tiny, little, cosmically insignificant creatures in this immense universe. We've always known that. That's what the psalmist said in that famous line in Psalm 8, which in the King James Version literally only speaks about half of us, but means all of us, right? What is man that thou art mindful of him? How can we mean anything in this immensity of it all? And one of the ways we deal with that is to embed ourselves, because we're small and we live here in our individual lives for a tiny bit of time, into this larger immensity, immediately into our own family lines by tracing our own lineages back further into the family lines of the phyletic history of the creatures we share the planet with. It hits us hard, and that's why I did make that comparison. I wrote essays for Natural History magazine for 300 months in a row and never missed one. And somehow that got me musing. I'm not going to stop writing, of course. I'm just going to stop writing monthly for Natural History magazine. One could as soon stop writing as stop breathing. That's when I'll stop writing, of course. But I thought that for the last essay, I'd try and make that point explicitly. It is amazing when you think about it. Life has been here 3.5 billion years. If it had ever ended for 1 second, we wouldn't be here. The skein would have been broken forever. How many processes can go on that long and never once cross the zero line? It's almost, I realize the probability of crossing that zero line may be very low, but you had 3.5 billion years and never to have done it once. That is a record of astonishing proportions. It leaves Mr. DiMaggio and essays, strings, and anything else human beings have done utterly in the dust. And yeah, I thought to celebrate
compare,
that.
You compare it, you know, a healthy Mark McGuire.
Yeah, the reason I made
you the question is, what is it that explains, that could explain the continuity? The fact that the light never went out, 3.5 billion years.
Yeah, never once. Yeah, the reason I made the comparison to Maguire, what I said was that, you know, if you had Maguire playing for 3.5 billion years, there might be 1 year where he'd hit zero home runs. It's very improbable, but it wouldn't make the phenomenon go away. He'd be back next year. But life doesn't work that way. If life had ever crossed that zero line, however improbable, even once, it would have ended. We wouldn't be here. And yet here we are in this enormous richness of millions of species of organisms. The Earth never froze. The sun never exploded. The Earth was never struck by a body large enough to wipe out all of life. It's astonishing. It's factual, but it's astonishing, and here we are.
Go back to the story of your grandparents, and it is a sentimental story, but it's full of the stuff of connection. I wondered what you meant to say, though, about the strategies, the bonding, the accidents, the chance, the learned rules of success in a migration, in a new country, of these two people who had not just an interesting life, but interesting children and grandchildren. What, beside the mere fact of continuity, what do you learn from their story about the tactics of it and the setbacks of it, about the bigger story?
I think the main point I was trying to make is how utterly ordinary the story is in its heroism, and that everyone's family line has a tale like that. It was a good way to end the series because my grandfather landed in the United States as a 14-year-old boy in 1901. This is my last essay for January 1901. And the reason I knew the date is that I have his old, humble little English grammar book that he bought a month after he landed here. And he wrote on it, first the date of his acquisition, October 25th, 1901, and then he wrote just below it in pencil, in this very elegant European hand, with incorrect grammar, because he didn't know the difference among the various past tenses of English yet. He wrote, "I have landed," September 1st, 1901. And he should have wrote, "I landed," because he was talking about something he'd done a couple months ago. But, hey, he didn't know the difference between the compound and the simple past yet. And somehow that was just so eloquent, "I have landed." And that date allowed me, thanks to a reader who turned out to be a researcher in Passenger List, to send me the manifest. And I ended up with this piece of paper showing his arrival on Ellis Island, this humble little piece of paper announcing Joseph Rosenberg from this tiny little town in eastern Hungary. And my grandmother's story was similar. She came 10 years later, had a falling out with her father, came under the sponsorship of an aunt in 1910. In 1911, on the day of the Triangle Shirtwaist Fire, she was a shirtwaist worker, but working for another company a few blocks away. It's through the luck of things like that that people join and get together. They met, they married, they had four children. One of them's my mother. They struggled. They reached the lower bounds of the middle classes. They prevailed.
You speak of luck, but you also make it sound inevitable. Is anything in the Darwinian scheme inevitable?
Oh, no, there's nothing inevitable. That's the heroism of it. I think that's the problem with inevitability. It's the problem with all fatalist points of view, even if you don't know what you're destined to be, and therefore, in a sense, you may be surprised by it. Somehow, philosophically, the very fact that it needs to occur, I think, detracts from its glory. No, it was a strange mixture of fortitude and good fortune. And that's why any of us are here today. But you need the fortitude as well as the good fortune. And that's why we can call such stories heroic in the usual human sense of that term. It's not just luck, and it's not just skill.
Steve, put it in the general context of sort of Darwinian thinking today. Of course, Darwin, although himself he was ambiguous about religious faith, he did take sort of God's creative hand in making those individual species sort of out of the process. A lot of people go vastly further to say there's none of this human emotion to be associated with this process. None of your kind of fervent excitement, enthusiasm, awe, human and emotional connection to be associated with it. How risky is it to kind of not anthropomorphize exactly, but to see so much human resonance in this long process?
Oh, I think you have to make a strict separation, Chris, in that sense, I'm totally with Darwin. Whatever Darwin's personal religious views, I don't think he ever figured it out. He would have borrowed his friend Huxley's term agnostic to describe himself. He certainly felt that there might be some force that we would want to call creative in a conventional sense behind the general laws of nature, but he certainly argued that the actual particular events that occur, the birth and death of each species over 3.5 billion years, is a question to be understood by scientific investigation. And I very much agree with that. In even to be able to talk about its awesomeness or its impact upon you, I think you do have to make a strict separation between its ascertainable scientific status and what it means to you. Those are separate subjects. There's a factuality out there, which is whatever it is, whether we like it or not, and that factuality then speaks to our emotions in a certain way, and it will not speak to everyone in the same way. And I think as long as we keep those separate, I think it is the job of a scientist to recognize that however a certain set of facts is best understood impacts his own emotions has to be kept separate insofar as you can. I mean, obviously, we're drawn to study certain subjects. Why am I a paleontologist rather than a physicist? In part, it's because I don't do that kind of mathematics, but in part, it's what struck me personally. But I have to keep as much as I possibly can that separate from my assessment of the factuality of nature.
I want to continue the thought into this thicket of sociobiology, which is suddenly crawling again and burning around the Yanomami question and the Napoleon Chagnon research in the Amazon regions of South America. This has churned up a huge new war again with Patrick Tierney's book, Darkness at El Dorado, and suddenly this whole question of whether it's genes that make people fierce or something else, whether indeed the Yanomami were all that fierce before Chagnon got there, how it should be explained. What's the short Steve Gould take on the question of relating evolution to psychology, human performance, even the drives that brought Papa Joe and your Grammy to New York 100 years ago?
I think the short take, which is unfortunately not very profound or normative or doesn't resolve a great deal, is that whatever emotional behavioral predispositions we might have obtained evolutionarily, and which therefore may in part and only in part reside within us genetically, they're not for the most part determinative. They may give us certain predispositions to certain kinds of behaviors, but what's overwhelmingly true about humans is the great flexibility that we have to alter even those behaviors to which we're predisposed if we decide that they're immoral or that they don't fit well with current technological capacities. For example, maybe it was under certain circumstances with sticks and stones adaptively advantageous to be nasty to our neighbors. It certainly may not be in a nuclear world. The other fact that's relevant, which is a real discovery of the last 20 years, is that all human beings alive today share a much more recent African common ancestry than we ever thought, and therefore we're just so much more similar one to the other. You can't look at a group, whether it's the Yanomami in South America, the Khoisan of Southern Africa, the Finns of Northern Europe, and say, well, they're different because they're just different people. We're all so similar. The genetic differences among even our culturally and geographically most disparate groups are so much smaller than we ever thought even a few years ago.
When did we now have to see
that is coming out of our different flexibilities.
When did we discover that?
Really, only in the last 20 years, because before that you could not measure. There were no techniques whereby you could measure the average genetic differences among human beings.
But so, and what's the, where do we go from that understanding that we are, the human brain, basically, the world around, is born the same?
Towards an understanding that the enormous cultural differences among far-flung people in different parts of the globe are coming out of a common genetic heritage that we all share and therefore are not due to particular and highly specific determinative genes that are held by one group of people and not by others. We're a very variable species, but that variability exists within each of our populations. It doesn't distinguish differences between them.
Well, then, but then when the Yanomami say Stone Age people in the highlands of Brazil are studied and described first as the fierce people, and then described as sort of playing out our genetic inheritance with a tremendous rate of male conflict. What generalization should be drawn from something like that?
I can't comment. I haven't even read Tierney's book, though I have it. I've never met Dr. Chagnon. I can't comment on the details of that controversy. It may well be that certain groups of folks have fairly high degrees of aggressivity, but there are other groups that have been described in other parts of the world that are equally pacific and therefore show, again, the enormous range within Homo sapiens, but I can't comment on the actual merits of one side or another of the particular Yanomami case.
When people do start talking, though, Steve Gould, about the evolution of social behavior, of social roles, in analogy to the development of, a bird's claws or beaks or eyes or whatever, I mean, physical characteristics, what general cautions do you toss down about evolution in social behavior?
To recognize, to continue that analogy, if you want to make it to the bird's claws or beaks, that what you're talking about in Homo sapiens, again, ranging from the Yanomami to the Finns to the Khoisan, you're making an analogy to the form of the beak in one species of bird. You're not talking about the very different beaks, even of different species of Darwin's finches, that are adapted to very different environments through the selection of different genes. You're talking about variation within one single species, and therefore you're not talking about genetically and evolutionarily set differences. You're talking about different ways of expressing in different social circumstances a common genetic heritage that all human beings share.
Stephen Jay Gould is our guest. On the occasion, it's always a good occasion, any good excuse, but on the occasion of his 300th consecutive essay in the monthly Natural History, Unbroken, like Joe DiMaggio's 56-game hitting streak, and it's probably about as rare in magazine publishing for a lot of different reasons, partly because he doesn't want to go out hobbling like Willie Mays. Stephen Jay Gould says this is his last in this series, and it's a very personal story about his own grandparents as a kind of his family experience of the persistence of life these last 3.5 billion years. 1-800-423-8255 makes the Stephen Jay Gould connection. Ron is calling from Oaks, North Dakota.
Yes.
Welcome, Ron.
Thank you very much. Professor Gould, it's wonderful to talk to you. I've read some of your books.
Thank you. It's a pleasure to hear from one of those states that has two senators and only one member of the House of Representatives.
And our representative is a Democrat and had this...
God bless you.
Had he gone to the House of Representatives since North Dakota went for President-elect Bush, he was going to vote for Bush had it gone that far. He had made that known. But at any rate, my question deals with what I thought was one of your most fascinating essays, the islands that were formed in Hawaii by the lava fields.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought that your discussion of evolution within those islands was a beautiful proof of evolution. And the other thing I'd like you to comment on is Kenneth Miller's book, Finding Darwin's God. As a religious person, I was kind of relieved to read that book and to see the dovetailing he did with religion and evolution.
Me too.
Because
me too.
I believe in both. And I'd like you to comment on that.
No, I think we all agree with that. Ken Miller's been a friend of mine for ages. He is a religious Catholic and one of the most effective spokespeople for evolution in the country. In fact, because he's a good debater, given that verbal Irish heritage of his, he's actually gone out there and just trounced Duane Gish and Morris and all those other creatious debaters. I generally don't think you ought to debate them in public because it just gives them the publicity we don't want to heap upon them, but Miller has absolutely trounced them. But all he's doing and has been doing is, in fact, supporting the traditional Catholic perspective is validated by popes ranging from Pius XII, not one of my favorite figures in 20th century history, to the current pope, namely that science and religion are separate things, and a religious person, a Catholic in particular, since that's their domain, may certainly believe whatever science finds out about the evolution of the human body, so long as they believe that at some point God chose to infuse the human soul into that natural entity. Now, I happen to have a different position about human souls, but that doesn't matter. That has nothing to do with science. That's not my bailiwick. I have no factually informed expertise on that particular subject. And no, I think what Ken is doing in that book is speaking for a large majority of both scientific people and religious professionals in the United States and in the world, for that matter, what has been the standard consensus position for 100 years that science and religion are entirely compatible because they deal with different issues. Science is about the factuality of nature insofar as we can determine it, and religion is about ethics, values, and the meaning of life, and science can't answer those questions, and religion is not meant to discourse on the world's factuality. The Bible's not a treatise on natural history, and science is not a moral compendium.
And the age of the rocks doesn't determine the Rock of Ages.
Yes, that famous line.
Yeah. did you want to speak to Ron's question or point about your Pacific Islands and evolution?
Oh, the Hawaiian Island case is very interesting because the Hawaiian Islands, since they've been formed sequentially in time, this is apparently one source of island material, a hotspot under the Pacific Ocean, the islands get older and older as you move away from the current volcanoes, which are over the big island towards Kauai at the northwest. So you have, in a sense, a natural chronometer. The islands get younger and younger from Kauai to the big island, and you can use that to calibrate the evolution of various forms that are living on those islands. That's why it's such a good case.
Ron, thank you for calling. 1-800-423-8255. Adam is on the line.
Hi, good morning.
Morning, Adam.
You guys touched on this briefly earlier in the show, but my question to Mr. Gould was, do you think that we as a species, due to our technological advancement and pseudo-control over our environment, have we escaped from the natural selection? And if your answer is no, we haven't, then what do you think the current selection pressures on us are?
I think it's funny. I'm glad you asked that. That question is always asked, because it's a good question, mind you. But nonetheless, it is based upon a misconception. I don't say that to be critical at all of the caller. It's a misconception that almost everyone has and is almost inevitable. But the misconception is that there's something about human culture that slows down, distorts, or in otherwise distresses the natural tendency of natural selection to weed out the weak and to preserve the strong, and that therefore, since we now can preserve the weak, that natural selection has ceased to operate in humans or has slowed down. The point, I think, is that natural selection is such a weak force anyway that given the enormous speed of human cultural change, which is a non-genetic special and unique style of change that's only come upon this planet with the evolution of human consciousness. By the way, human cultural change is Lamarckian. That's why it's so fast, because whatever we learn in one generation, we teach directly to the next. That gives technological changes.
But see, you say natural selection is a weak force. Weak force compared to what?
It's a weak force compared to the force of human cultural change, which has this Lamarckian push that whatever we invent in one generation, we pass on directly to the next. Natural selection continues to operate in humans. It probably operates with the same speed it always did, but that's too slow to amount to anything. Also, there's another misconception built into that, and that is the notion that natural selection is usually leading a species somewhere. Humans have been stable for at least 50,000 years. The people who painted those caves in Chauvet 30,000 years ago were us, and the beauty of the art speaks to that directly, even though we know the bones and the brain size also tell us these are us. But that's what you expect. Large species tend to be highly stable. The changes that occur in Homo sapiens are local and fluctuating. They go back and forth. forth. That's what natural selection usually does. Natural selection rarely is leading an entire species in some progressive or general direction. The natural history of most species during most of the time is to be stable, and that's what natural selection is doing to us now. The directional forces in human history are all the result of this powerful and different force of cultural change.
But we're not under that kind of evolutionary pressure right now. You say we're somewhere in the stability run,
which is the standard situation for most highly successful, stable, worldwide species. That's only talking about our biological nature. That's what I say when
yes.
you talk about the differences between Yanomami and Finns and all of us. You can't attribute that to evolutionarily established disparities because it's all a result of the different potentialities of a common genetic heritage. We've been stable for that long, but we are a very unstable and rapidly changing species, but not for reasons of Darwinian natural selection and altering genetic biology. We're unstable and unpredictable because we've unleashed this new and different force of cultural change, which is not genetic and which doesn't follow the same slow and steady rules of Darwinian natural selection.
Steve, I want to, when we come back,
Lamarckian.
When we come back from a short break, I want you to give us, if you can, a sort of a short scorecard on these Darwinian debates, including the war on sociobiology, and the disagreements among the Dennetts and the Dawkinses and the Wrights and the Goulds of the world. This is The Connection from WBUR Boston. Funding for The Connection comes from the listeners of WBUR Boston, where The Connection is produced, and from the Allaire Corporation, empowering people with innovative internet technology and offering dynamic career opportunities at allaire.com.
From Boston.
I'm Christopher Lydon. This is the Stephen Jay Gould Connection. We're talking about one of the great writing lifetimes and careers in biology. Stephen Jay Gould, the author of many scientific bestsellers and 300 consecutive essays in Natural History magazine. The phone's 1-800-423-8255 or 1-800-423-TALK or join us online at theconnection.org. Stephen Jay Gould, we won't go back over the Yanomami argument and what, if anything, made them fierce. The thing we still want to figure out, though, is what makes the anthropologists so fierce around this subject of genetic determinism, also about the direction of evolution, whether it's upward toward man or just sort of across into chaos. But
neither? Just not upward anywhere, but ordered by its topology of the tree of life.
Whatever that is. Go back, and when you look out there, even probably into your mailbag, and see the red-hot passion in this argument around who made us, what made us, what makes us the way we are, how do you sort out the categories? Who's right, who's wrong?
Oh, first of all, you have to understand why the passion is so high, and I think that goes back to a famous statement by Freud, who said that the truly great revolutions are the ones that disturb our own sense of what we once arrogantly took to be our self-importance. And there have been two great revolutions. The first was the Galileo and Copernicus's, and the second was Darwin's. Now, we know how tumultuous the first one was. We know what happened to Galileo, but, you know, that was only about real estate. That was about whether we're on the central body of the universe or peripherally somewhere. The Darwinian revolution is the big one, because that's about essence. That's about who we are and what we're related to. So that it should be so passionate is in some sense not surprising. And of course, people are always looking, I think, in large degree inappropriately to science for an answer to questions that trouble them about themselves and their own species. Clearly, there are many things about our behaviors and our histories that either we don't like or that puzzle us. After all, this is a vale of tears, and we've known since the Book of Job that very bad things happen to very good people, and those questions are not soluble, and we seek to solve them through this powerful mechanism of science. So it might occur to some people, well, maybe we can solve them because we're actually made that way. Maybe we're made not to behave in ways that would make this life better for all of us. Maybe we should accept it because it's an evolutionary inevitability, or maybe we shouldn't accept it, but at least understand that it's an evolutionary inevitability, and then maybe we can learn to manipulate it. To me, those are very simplistic answers. I don't think we're going to get the answer to any kind of moral question, certainly not that one, from scientific factuality. I'm afraid I feel the best we can do from evolutionary theory is to learn what we all share in common as members of a single species, as all humans are. And the best we're going to learn is that we have some very broad evolutionarily based behavioral predispositions, which are enormously modifiable by cultural differences and cultural change. We're not going to get the answer to what we don't like about ourselves. It's not going to be directly programmed out of our evolutionary biology.
But does that explain why when people find in the Yanomami, or they say they find, the kind of fierce fighting heritage that we all humans learned in the evolutionary plain of East Africa, the argument is suddenly life and death? And great reputations are at stake here in that fight.
First of all, I'm not even sure it's true about that one particular group in South America. But even if it were, there are hundreds of human groups with as broad a range of culturally set behaviors on that particular issue as we have within our own culture today in the United States. There's no one group, whatever it does, that either specifies the basic genetic biology of the entire species Homo sapiens or tells us what evolution has made us.
Deal with another argument, this sort of the direction, no direction argument that comes up a lot on this program. Robert Wright's argument is that without evolution necessarily being purposely guided by a creator, it does favor a certain kind of communicative, cooperative activity at the level of the slug or at the level of Homo sapiens. He takes the view that over, if the world were wiped out and started again, in a few many billions of years, we'd come back to it something very like a human being because the process favors the selection of kinds of social beings like us. You tend to say it wouldn't happen.
It's such a curious argument when you think of it. Life has been on this planet for 3.5 billion years. There is one species, which is one out of 200 species of primates, which are a minor order within a group called the mammals that comprise 4,000 species, which are a minor group within the vertebrates, which comprise 40,000 species, which are themselves a minor group among the animals, because if you want to designate any group as most successful, it's surely the insects with more than a million described species, who are themselves a small group with respect to the truly dominant forms of life on this planet, which are bacteria.
Mm-hmm.
If there is, therefore, a clear and necessary direction, and if it leads to the kind of social cohesiveness embodied in human systems, then why one species on the one planet we know where it happened? I would expect to see it as a multiple parallel trend pervading the history of life, and I don't. I see it as the curious, albeit glorious and wondrous invention of one peculiar little lineage. That, to me, does not speak to inevitability.
Except people of his... Well, lots of others, too, would say these things do. The eye has evolved many times. Not every eye on an insect or a human or a mouse comes from the same original accident. There have been many starts toward that end.
Right? Well, it's not that simple, Chris. The structures that are capable of some form of light perception, and often it's not the ability to form an image, it's just light-sensitive cells,
right,
have evolved 40 to 60 times. I think you have a basic substrate of transparent proteins that can play this role. However, the lens eye, which has evolved in six different groups of animals. In fact, though it used to be cited as a standard example, just as you said, of independent, utterly independent evolutionary events, which therefore indicate a kind of inevitability given a substrate of possibility, which evolution has to give you, turns out that's not strictly true. Hmm. The eye of the squid and the human, which are so very similar, they are not entirely the same. Of course they're not. They're built of different body tissues. That part of the argument is right. But one of the most fascinating discoveries of the last 20 years is that there are shared genetic pathways. Even though these groups have been separate for more than 500 million years, there are shared genetic pathways in the development of eyes in mollusks, the squid eye, in vertebrates, in insects, which had a very different kind of moldable lens eye. In fact, the squid gene and the human gene, when applied to the leg of a fly, will build a fly's eye on its leg. That, in fact, there is this enormous genetic retention of a common potentiality. It's not just convergence showing the inevitability of this higher form of perception.
1-800-423-8255 makes the connection with the paleontologist and the writer Stephen Jay Gould on the occasion of his 300th and final monthly essay in Natural History magazine. Michael is on the line.
Yes, and you know, would that cultural evolution were directional, but I think we've got a case of regression to the mean. Millions of children are being educated solely in creationism this year and in the coming years, and well, our national government is now completely in the hands of people who at least publicly espouse at least sympathy for anti-evolutionary ideas and whose best friends are rabidly creationist, and you know, I think would rather have that taught alone. I'm just wondering, how do we culturally cope with this divide? And you know, who do you think will be showing up in our universities in 15 years?
I'm not quite as pessimistic as you. I'm very saddened by the whole issue. First of all, I think some of the noises that politicians make, from our current president-elect to Mr. Reagan, even to Al Gore, I'm sorry to say, on one occasion, though he knows better, I think they are just political noises to placate a constituency. I know, for example, that Ronald Reagan was a great believer in and fascinated by human evolution, though he had a constituency that led him to make other noises at certain times, and I trust the same is so with our current president-elect. I think they understand that evolution is factually so. There may be some political benefits in saying otherwise. But I do put a great deal of trust in our Constitution, maybe a little less in our Supreme Court over the last couple of days. But at least so far, given the First Amendment and its guaranteed protections of separation of church and state, we have never lost a major court case on the teaching of evolution and attempts to force creationism, which is nothing more than a minority among religious folks, very
but he has an
literalist viewpoint. So I think evolution will continue to be taught. You're right, the questioner is right, that millions of people, despite the fact that we win our court victories in the public schools, are being taught in homes and private schools the opposite, and that's very sad. I certainly agree with the caller.
But will the next crop of college students come to, you know, freshman year with a different disposition?
I don't think so, Chris. I think most will be still coming through the public school system. We continue to win our cases in the public school system. We just defeated the school board of the state of Kansas, which had removed evolution as a necessarily taught subject. They didn't ban it, but they took it out of the required teaching of the state curriculum. We've beat them, and that will be back in the state curriculum as soon as the new school board constitutes itself,
Michael,
this fall. So I'm not totally pessimistic, but I certainly share the caller's deep concerns on those issues.
Michael, do you want to come back?
Well, you know, it may be nasty to characterize them this way, but the worst are filled with a passionate intensity. Every day on a local Christian radio outlet in the Boston area, you can hear at least one sustained, generally Philip Johnson-esque attack on evolution, on the sort of thing that people are trained in apologetics to give simple, flawed arguments against, say, teaching on the high school biology level, which is often not very good. It's often a blind recitation of facts, which can be met with a blind recitation of factoids.
It's a political battle, and we'll just have to beat them. We have so far prevailed, And I'm optimistic that we'll continue to do so. I see no trends that we won't. Again, I share your concerns. I totally agree that it's a battle that has to be fought every day that can't possibly be relaxed, and that the forces on the other side are always there and at the ready. But I don't see any reason to be pessimistic.
Michael, thank you. 1-800-423-8255 makes the connection with Stephen Jay Gould. Dana is on the line.
Good morning, Chris, and good morning, Mr. Gould.
Welcome, Dana.
Before I begin my piece, I'd just like to say I read your piece, Dinomania, last night, Mr. Gould. Yeah, it was great. I'm a Christian, but I find your rational voice in matters of evolution and science very refreshing from the wiseacrings of...
contradiction.
Well, thank you, but I did want to bring up something that might be a contradiction, at least a presumed contradiction, which is, I guess, to the heart of my question. Random variation, okay? I get the impression from scientists such as yourself that just because, you know, there's a very strong case, most likely that, you know, we're here randomly, so to speak, or that life, you know, certain species evolved through random variation and luck, you know, the environment happened to be right, that sort of somehow discredits the idea of a supreme being or deity because, you know, who says, I mean, what do you think about the idea that God may not necessarily, or some supreme being, may not necessarily micromanage every little leaf that falls off a tree, you know?
I would agree with you. That would be my position. No, I think two points.
What does that do to sort of intercessory prayer, the idea of a personal God that, you know, his eye is on the sparrow and I know he watches me?
Well, I don't think it contradicts it at all. I mean, God may intervene when someone asks him to. I mean, I believe that, and I believe in prayer. But things left as they are, I don't necessarily think that it's God's will that a leaf fall a certain way or that perhaps maybe a meteor smashed into the earth 65 million years ago and made open the door for the mammals to evolve now that most of the dinosaurs had been, so to speak, you know. And I'm just generalizing here, but...
They're good questions.
Yeah. No, I would make two points to Dan. He's absolutely right. First of all, I would say that it's a misconception to say that because variation is random, that Darwinian evolutionists say that everything about the history of life is random. Variation is only the fuel that natural selection uses. Natural selection is a locally deterministic force. It adapts animals to their immediate local environments. The problem is that the history of local environments through time doesn't have a directionality, but it's not as though Darwinian processes are entirely random ones. They're locally deterministic, but local determinism through time cashes out that way. On your second point, although I don't actually share your religious background, I entirely agree with your point. In fact, it's been the conventional argument since the late 17th century in Newton's generation among religious people, particularly among Christian scientists. I mean, scientists who are Christian. Namely, that it's more befitting the dignity of God that he should set up the laws of nature in a certain way at the very beginning of time, and then, as you put it very well, it's a good phrase, not micromanage the universe. Mm-hmm. And therefore, the details of what happens in evolution are not the result of a divine placing of the finger into the works of nature at every moment, but are based upon natural laws that were established at the beginning.
Like George W. Bush, he's a delegator. That's what George W. Bush says we need. 1-800-423-8255. Moyne is listening online in Coral Springs, Florida.
That is correct. Good morning, Chris and Professor Gould. I am a great fan of your articles as well as that of your intellectual sparring partner, Richard Dawkins. And I would like to touch a little about evolutionary psychology and get your impressions on that. We know quite a bit based on this new area of evolutionary psychology, how based on competition and the environment that human thinking has evolved over a period of time. My question is...
Do we?
At least to a certain extent. I think there are some good works from Cosmidis and Tooby, and I think a recent book on human nature by Paul Ehrlich was a good one, too. It kind of threw some new light on that, too. So at least, I think some...
I think he's quite out of sympathy with Cosmides and Tooby, but go ahead. I'm sorry. I didn't...
All right. Okay. My question is, as we evolve, both I don't know to what extent at what rate we are evolving biologically, but it appears to me that perhaps the rate in psychological terms is a little more rapid, given the fact over the last 100 years and with the coming of the industrial and information revolution, we have kind of catapulted in our rate of evolutionary psychological evolution.
Yeah, but none of that is biological evolution. There's been no biological change in 100 years.
That is right.
Cultural
alteration. So to speak, I think the software, that is the mind, has evolved pretty rapidly.
It's changed.
Yeah, because I think, and now, for instance, if you look at the world today, we are interacting with a variety of information appliances and even machines, which the kind of stimuli which the human mind has not processed, say, even 300 or 400 years back. So I would like to get your impressions on how this is going to be in the years to come. Any speculations? I would welcome some speculations.
No, that's
not how long, how far out a prediction would you like, mine?
I'm not going to be able to give one anyway. No, that's the great question. And unfortunately, it's exactly where evolutionary biology can't help very much, because all of this immense change and danger and new context is without any input from my field of evolutionary biology. That is, evolutionary biology made us Homo sapiens who we are, but during the last 100 years, there's been no genetic or evolutionary change in human nature. We are dealing with this new technological situation with the exact same evolutionary tools we had when we painted those caves 30,000 years ago. Mm-hmm. And I don't think, therefore, there's going to be much enlightenment from the evolutionary science of how genetic change comes about, because that's not what we need. And that's not what's causing our current dilemmas. That's why I don't even like to use the phrase cultural evolution. I always talk about cultural change, because I think the disanalogies are greater than the analogies. If you're talking about cultural change and you want a biological metaphor, I think epidemic is much better than evolution.
1-800-423-8255 makes the Stephen Jay Gould connection. Mike is calling from Warwick, Rhode Island.
Yeah, hi, Professor Gould.
Hi.
Apparently, everybody always thought that life formed on pools of water on the surface, but recently, these hot smokers way under the ocean, thousands of feet under the ocean, have totally different thing where the chemistry was by hydrogen sulfide and heat and complete darkness, and these huge tube worms formed. And I really wanted to know what you think, if that's possible, that life actually, formed there as opposed on the surface. And apparently, this moon of Jupiter, Europa, has a water ocean as big as Earth's or maybe bigger. And, it's geothermal activity, so the same kind of activity could have happened there.
Yeah, the tube worms have much, they're pogonophorans, they're members of a group that evolved elsewhere, we know them well. The main point about the so-called smokers is it shows there's more than one environment on the current Earth which is capable or is of the right set of conditions for what could have marked the origin of life billions of years ago. And I think that's very interesting. And that does, as you correctly point out, tie into much more optimism than we had even 10 years ago for the possibility at least of life of bacterial level. We're not talking about tube worms, which are complicated creatures, evolving in other parts of the solar system. There are bacteria living on the Earth, we now understand, up to a couple miles down under the Earth's surface in pore spaces and rocks through which water and other fluids can percolate. There was water on Mars for the first billion years of its history. There still is water in the ice caps, a little bit or a little bit of fluid, but underneath the frozen permafrost, there may yet be life of bacterial level on Mars. I think it's a long shot. You mentioned Europa. So once you understand the extreme environments in which life at bacterial level can survive, it gives you a lot more optimism, not for little green men, but for the possibility that we may yet even discover life of bacterial level in our own solar system.
Optimism, you say. Would it be good news, Steve Gould, to find that life elsewhere?
It would be enormously good news, just because it would be so interesting. It would be the most interesting thing we ever found out, Chris. You see, we don't. All life on Earth shares this immensely common biochemistry. All has DNA and RNA. It all uses ATP for energy storage. And the great question is, do we share those features because that's the only way it could happen? Or do we share it by the accident that we're all descendants of one common ancestor on a single tree of life? The only way to answer that is to find life elsewhere and see whether it's the same or different.
Steve Gould, we'll keep looking and we'll keep calling. It's such a pleasure to have you on The Connection. Stephen Jay Gould, his 300th essay under the general heading This View of Life This one called I Have Landed can be found in the new Natural History magazine. Or you can continue the conversation on our website at theconnection.org. I'm Christopher Lydon. This is The Connection from WBUR Boston. Funding for The Connection comes